One thing that I often do, and I think we've talked about this, to prepare for debates, to prepare for conversations, or even just to see kind of where I stack up against great thinkers, and you would be certainly today's sort of great thinker, Mount Rushmore, I would say, is the first time I watch an interview, I'll watch the Kathy Newman portion and pause it before I hear your response, and I respond as though it's in real time. I'll do this with Bill Maher. I'll do it with, Don Lemon. I'll do it with Kathy Newman, just to see how I would respond, so it's as close to a live simulation as possible. One thing that you handled superbly was very different. I noticed from where I took this, when she said, well, hold on a second, I'm talking about the transgender law in Canada. She said, why does your freedom of speech trump their right to not be offended? And I just paused it, and my answer was, there is no right to not be offended. But then play, and yours was actually, I thought, ooh, this might play against him. I thought it was a little too intellectual, but it actually drew her into a firefight to where you ultimately said, gotcha. You said, well, think about it. You need to have the right to be offensive because you need to have the right to dig into offend me. And that's absolutely something you should be doing. And you turned it in a personal analogy and telling her, giving her more free rein. And I think she was caught off guard by that. That was handled really well.
Well, she was, because it was so, the thing is, it was so patently obvious by that point that she was doing everything she possibly could to make me uncomfortable. She knew it. I knew it. The viewers knew it. There was no doubt about it. And it was easy just to point to that and then to say, well, perhaps that's what you should be doing. At least you certainly have the right to do that.
Right.
But that offense argument, we can break that down a little bit because that's worthwhile. It's like, okay, you don't have the right to say anything that offends someone else. It hurts their feelings. Okay. What if you're talking to 1,000 people? You don't have the right to say anything that's going to offend any one of those 1,000 people, which basically means you do not have the right to say anything at all. Because in a group of 1,000 people, virtually anything you say will be regarded as offensive by at least one person, even if it's merely a consequence of the fact that they're misinterpreting you. And so really, the absence of the right to offend is absence of the right to speak at all.
Right.
And that just seems so self-evident. All you have to do is think about it. And if it's not 1,000 people, what if you're Kathy Newman and you're talking to 1,000,000 people? Like, she's offending people nonstop. And she has to if she's going to be, well, no, seriously.
No, I know. And she doesn't understand it, though. She thinks, because I think this is important, she sees intent as the ultimate kind of value there. What trumps the action is the intent. Her intent isn't to offend. And she ascribes intent to you. Your intention was to offend. She even went as far as saying that, you know, to harm transgender people. I think in her eyes, it's okay for her to speak as long as she's not intending to hurt anyone's feelings. And people like, you know, your feelings don't matter so much to her.
Well, there's also a misinterpretation of my stance, because my stance had very little initially to do with transgender people. The whole issue of transgender phobia, let's say, is that the backlash from the radical leftists. What I said was that I would not use words that the government was compelling me to say. The fact that they happened hypothetically to be about transgender people was just a sideshow in some sense.
Yeah.
Not that their concerns are irrelevant, but that wasn't the point. If all this was about transgender pronouns, it would have disappeared, well, a year ago. It would have disappeared immediately. That's not the issue at all, and everyone knows it.
Right.
The issue really is that there's a culture war going on, and the radical leftists are trying to push an agenda on everyone, and they're doing it quite effectively. And I said that I wasn't going to play. I said specifically that I would not allow the radical leftists to define the linguistic territory.
Right.
And that was correct. And it's the right thing to do, because if the radical leftists define the linguistic territory, and the game we start playing is identity politics, right? So it's every group against every other group in a war against all, and that there's no real communication between the groups possible, and it's victim and victimizer narrative, and that's the way of the world. Then one of the things that does instantly is open the door to the identitarian right, who will say, okay, no problem. You can define the game. It's identity politics. I'm white. I'm white and male, let's say, and I'm not going to play to lose. I'm going to bloody well play to win. Because that's what the right-wing identitarians will do.
Right.
And that's, well, both of the whole, for me, the response to that is, let's just not play that game.
Right.
You know, in the Globe and Mail wrote an article, I think I mentioned this, where the headline was something about me being an angry white male. And I thought, I don't really care what you guys say about me. I like it bothers me or it doesn't bother me or bring it on or the what would you say, the controversy is useful or like there's lots of ways of interpreting it. I'd rather people didn't attack me for things that were untrue, although it's actually kind of a relief. It's better than to be attacked for things that are true, you know, in some sense. But I couldn't believe that our national newspaper was so goddamn dumb that they would title a article with a racial epithet. You know, it's like angry white man. I see. So this is what we're going to do in Canada, is it? We're going to start having this discussion and these discussions and we're going to label them with race. And that's how we're going to make Canada, which is already a very peaceful country, much more peaceful. That's your solution, you morons.
Well, you know, it's funny because that's what she accuses you of doing. She goes, you know, you're trying to stir it up a bit. You're trying to get divide people, men and women and trans. That's what she said about you. And then they go along with headlines like angry white male. Again, it's about intent. They go angry white male or patriarchal male. Well, it doesn't matter if this offends anybody because I didn't intend to. So it's okay. Publish. Print. They don't see that. They see you as trying to divide and conquer through truth. Well, and that's what's most concerning to me.
Well, yeah. The thing is that I'm not playing identity politics games. Like, I'm not going to view the world through the lens of your group identity.
Right.
And that means just stepping outside of that game completely. And that is what I did with 12 Rules for Life. Like, there's a little bit of political content in it. In chapter 11, rule 11, which is don't bother children when they're skateboarding. And it's a somewhat of a diatribe against the idea that boys should be socialized like girls, which I think is an absolutely appalling idea. And I also think it's an idea for which there is absolutely no justification in the psychological literature. So I kind of touch on politics there, but more because politics has invaded a sphere it should stay the hell out of.